Genesis. Yo. In wickedness, I did not see fit to submit to lordship. Excited as if it's an accomplishment with iniquity, enjoyment, captive, and sin. Approved men who practiced it. Wrath against ungodly passion, suppressed in trenches with criminal intent. Without excuse, my conscience bears witness. Having new, didn't acknowledge God's existence. Evidence to the base intellect. My due recompense made what's wrong correct. I confess the madness, I had to disconnect. A hard-hearted wretch to progress to no limit.
You guys ready? You came to hear the word of God. Are you ready?
Yeah.
Hallelujah. It feels good in here, don't it?
Yeah.
Amen. Amen. Some good things happening in this ministry. Just hang around a little bit. I don't think it'll be long and we'll be planning another 29-11 somewhere.
Yeah.
It's not long. Say where? Well, I got some ideas. I got some feelings in my spirit of where we're going to go, what we're going to do. Just take a minute to get all the things figured out. Amen.
Amen.
Go ahead. How many of you think that this ministry ought to be reproduced somewhere else?
Amen. Absolutely.
Hallelujah. I told you years ago, when I was just a young preacher, a young pastor, I didn't know how, still not always sure how, but the Lord has spoken to my heart and said, I'm going to bring to you people and you will equip them, you will train and equip them for ministry.
Amen.
You will raise them up in your house and you will send them out and you'll plant other churches. And I thought, dear God, I don't even know what I'm doing in this church. How in the world am I going to do that? Listen, here's how a healthy church body should work according to the New Testament pattern. It should be self-supporting, number one. Amen?
Amen.
Then, in-house, the Bible says this, that a pastor should be able to teach. How many of you remember me telling you that?
Yes.
I've heard preachers get in the pulpit and say, well, now I'm not much of a teacher. Well, then sit down. Because the Bible said that the pastor must do the work of an evangelist and he must be able to teach. Yes. If your pastor is not able to teach, go elsewhere.
Amen.
Amen. Wow, that's good stuff. The three of you that love me. If your pastor cannot teach you the word of God, go elsewhere. You are wasting your time. The number one thing God wants done in the church body, he wants you taught the uncompromising word of God so that you can go out and change the world. Preachers, listen, I told you and I'll tell you again. Preachers are a dime a dozen. Ask Brother Arwood. He's been around this thing a long time. Preachers are a dime a dozen. Somebody who will get up here, shout, hoot, and holler, make you feel good and make you giggle. That is not the main purpose of the church. If that happens, wonderful. But the number one thing that should be going on through our services, you should be taught what the Word of God says, how to live it, how to apply it in your life, and watch it come to pass.
Amen.
Right.
You know, my wife and it's important we go to the Salvation Army because we've slept down there, that Salvation Army. We watch the Word of God take us from living in the back of a Ford Explorer to pastoring this church, starting a Bible school, and me becoming the boss of where I'm at, making decent money. You hear me?
Amen.
Well, I'm not much of a teacher. Then sit down and shut up. You're doing them a disservice.
Amen.
If they want to jump and holler and play and laugh, let them watch something on Comedy Central.
Come on, baby.
But see, when your kids get diagnosed with cancer, you need to know how the Word of God works.
Amen.
When your job is cut off and you have no lifeline, you need to know how the Word of God works, not cute little funny story.
Amen.
That's
so we've made it an endeavor here in this ministry. You will learn the Word of God.
Praise the Lord.
And I will say this, I believe over the years that we've been doing this, we've helped more people than we've made angry.
Yeah.
We made a whole pack of them angry. But it's never on purpose. You understand, I have a great love for God and His people.
Amen.
And I approach the Word of God with reverence and awe. And I don't just talk about things for the sake of having a cute little sermon. The things that I share with you are things that I have studied in and out for years and years and years.
Amen.
And there was a time when I did. Now listen, this is how I learned. One time I jumped on the bandwagon because some of the big name preachers that I like had started teaching some. So I taught it for about a year until the Holy Spirit taught me something, showed me the truth in the Word of God. Then I had to get up and stand before God's people and say, listen, I was wrong.
Amen.
I jumped on the bandwagon, but I've been teaching you wrong. Let's fix this.
Amen. Praise God.
You understand? So I've learned over the years, look, there's nothing wrong with being wrong, but when you find out, get up and fix it.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
And don't be so prideful to say you were wrong. So here in this church, you will learn the Word of God. Amen.
Amen.
I like it. I'm the first one. And when the Holy Spirit's here, man, we can shout, we can jump, we can run, we can dance. Say, why would you do that? Well, why wouldn't you? That's my question. Why wouldn't you?
Absolutely.
Huh? If you get it, you're going to be miserable in heaven if you're at one of them stuffy churches.
Right.
You'll be miserable. Is it, man, that sounds like the singing in heaven, said it sounds like tens of tens of tens of thousands of people.
Praise God.
Well, I don't go for all that falling on the floor stuff. Well, it says the elders, they get so excited, they throw their crown at the deal, and they fall down on their face. They throw their crowns at the throne and fall. Well, that must be really dignified in heaven. Here you go, fall. I'm on there. There should be an excitement in the church. But I've spent 20 years of my life studying this thing. So I don't just get up here and waste your time with cute stories and jokes. And so we don't just hoop and holler and feel good. But when your kids are diagnosed with something, you have the answers to fix it.
That's right.
But when somebody in your family, their life is falling apart, you've got the tools to come in and bridge that gap. And talking to Beverly, one place in Isaiah, it says we are called to be repairers of the breach. What is that? The breach between mankind and God.
Yes.
See, it is our job to put one hand on the hurting and one hand on heaven and pull the two together.
Amen.
That's our job.
It's
our job in the kingdom. And so I've got to teach you how to fix your problems, because most of the church body focuses on their problem rather than the answer.
That's right.
How many of you here, just by raising your hand, have had something this week you needed to deal with that wasn't real fun? Okay, then here's my job. Here's my admonition to you. Quit whining, get over it, and get about kingdom business.
That's right. Come on.
25 other people right next to you that are going through something. Okay? The Bible says this in one place, the same problems you're going through are being accomplished in your brethren throughout the world. Why would Peter say that? He said it's a wake-up call. We're all going through something. But the kicker is we are going through. We're not camping there on that. We're going to figure out how to get through it. So you're going to learn the Word of God. Preachers are a dime a dozen, man. I told y'all, if I locked the doors here tomorrow, if I turned in my keys, there would be people lined up outside waiting to take this congregation. Now it'd fall apart because I'm the one that's supposed to do it.
That's right.
You don't need just somebody that can preach and make you hoop and feel good. You need a pastor that can teach you the Word of God, how to apply it to your daily life. One man said this, putting a handle on the Bible so you can take it with you.
Amen.
Did I tell you to go to John chapter 15 yet?
No.
Well, then we must not have been there. Go to John chapter 15. The title of today's sermon. Now here's what I was taught in Bible school. They said a good sermon, it has a good catchy title, 3 points and a poem. I don't have a poem today. Listen, those of you guys in Bible school, I have one sermon that I go, well, I have two now since it took a while, but it's grown to two sermons that I go to in case I'm ever called somewhere to preach and I'm not ready. Bible says be ready to give an answer, be instant in season and out of season.
Yeah.
But really, in fact, here's how it should work. Those of you that are part of this ministry, you get enough teaching on people say, why do you just have one sermon? Because I believe that you get enough teaching and ministry of the Holy Spirit in one sermon, we don't have to drag out 4 or 5 services.
Amen.
Huh? We'll come here, we'll meet with truth, we'll meet with the Creator, and then we'll go spend time with our families on Sunday afternoon like we should. I enjoy each other.
Amen.
Bask in the present. Chew on what we were given.
Yes.
Amen. John 15:8. So that those of you who are going to school or called to preach, here's what I would tell you. Keep a sermon on the back burner, just in case. I'm the kind of guy, I may just call on you and tell him, hey, go ahead.
But I've always been, it's not, what am I going to preach, it's which one.
Right. And so I was taught in the school I went to, he said, Barney Fife was smart enough to keep a bullet, one bullet in his gun. Keep one bullet in your gun at all times, man. You never know when you're going to need it. I said that to say that if I've done my job right, you guys know the book of Hebrews he wrote, the author of Hebrews, there's controversy on who wrote it, but he said the time comes when you ought to be teachers. He was talking to the general congregation. Each and every one of you should be able to sit down with somebody and teach them exactly what I have taught you if I've done my job right.
Amen.
Why? Every seed reproduces after its kind.
Yes.
When the little guys come up on a bicycle or bringing you the watchtower that says awake, you should be able to sit down and show them the truth of the Word of God and the error of what they're teaching.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. If I give you the right tools. So here's the thing. Anytime, listen, I don't generally study to get sermon. Here's what I was taught, that you let the Word of God so fill you that when you stand up, the overflow of the Word and relationship of God that's in your heart just comes flooding out.
Amen.
Jesus said, from your innermost being will flow a river of living water, talking about being filled with the Holy Ghost. The Word of God is the living water, the Word of God.
Amen.
So you should get so close to God, so acquainted with God. Here's where a lot of people go. Let me tell you, the Bible says in Hebrews, again, that the Word of God, it is quick. That means it is alive. Really, we can break it down. Those of you who know it, really, here's how it is. It's charged with Zoe, the life of the eternal one.
Yeah.
Jesus said, my words, they are spirit and they are truth. They are pneuma and they are zoe. They are the breath of God and they are the life of God. If you want to get over and you want to know God, you will never know God apart from knowing the Word of God.
Amen.
And that's plumbing the depths of it yourself. Paul told the Berean church, he said, you're more noble than the church in Thessalonica. Because when I came to Berea and taught, you guys didn't just take my word for it. You went and searched the scriptures and found out what I told you was true.
Amen.
Yeah. There are a lot of congregations being misled. I didn't say going to hell or false prophet, but being misled and missing the full truth, the full counsel of the Word of God. Because a guy takes a couple things out of context, builds a whole ministry on it, and you've got 400 people believing a lie. Why? They never took the time to plumb the depths of the Word of God for themselves. John 15, verse 8. The catchy little title today is Tutti Frutti.
Tutti Frutti.
Huh? We had one a couple weeks ago called what? Smoking Deacons and Cussing Pastor. Had absolutely nothing to do with it, but it was a good title. So the sermon title today is Tutti Frutti, John 15, verse 8. It says, herein is my Father glorified, that ye bear much fruit. So shall ye be my disciples. Jesus puts a direct correlation to his disciples and people bearing fruit. Now go to Matthew 6, 2. That's going to give you a brief overview. Are you interested yet?
Amen.
Matt, I hope that I don't offend anything today but your religious sensibilities.
Come on.
Matthew 6, 2. Are you there?
Amen.
I want you to notice a little word, the second word. It says, thou for when. Everybody say when.
When.
Notice he didn't say if you feel like it, or if I feel led to. I told y'all before in one church service, when they came in, I handed out fishing weights to everybody that came in the door. And when they sat down, they said, Pastor, what is this fishing weight for? I said, I want you to keep it in your pocket. And when you see something in the Word of God, I want you to do it. And I want you to just put your hand in there and feel that, because that way you can always feel led.
Yeah.
Amen.
Wow.
This, that's a Christian loophole. That's a Christian loophole that in their blatant arrogancy and disobedience to the Word of God. That's our loophole. Well, I don't feel led. Right. Well, the Word of God told you to. That's like ministry to the poor. Well, I don't feel led. No, you are blatantly disobedient.
Amen.
You mean you're telling me you don't feel led to obey the Word of God? I'm just letting that sink in a minute. See, one of the worst teachings that have ever came into the body of Christ is where giving and receiving are concerned. It was a few people that were trying to get money for themselves and their ministry for sure. I know that for a fact. But talking about Spirit-led giving, what is Spirit-led giving? Let me tell you what that is. Here's how it's been taught and where it's wrong. See, we as the people of God, according to Galatians 6, it says, as we therefore have opportunity, do good unto all men. As we therefore have opportunity, do good unto all men. And then it says, especially unto the household of faith.
Amen.
And the Spirit-led giving came around. Well, you got to wait for God to lead you to give. No, Galatians 6:10 says that as I have an opportunity, I am to do good unto all men.
Right, come on.
Now where the Spirit-led part comes in is the Holy Spirit may say, no, don't give to that. They're a flim-flam artist.
Amen.
No, don't give to that. Their ministry has been in trouble for 20 years and they're pulling on your emotional strings to get money out of you. Don't try to bail out this sinking ship with a shot glass.
Amen.
Amen. Come on, Daddy.
And people getting up begging for, well, we're not going to be able to do this and that. Well, you know what? You were in trouble months before this ever happened.
That's right.
How you should have got with God months ago and got a God plan instead of asking everybody in your congregation to get a shot glass and start bailing you out.
Right.
Amen.
Amen.
And so here is where Spirit-led giving, here's really the right way of Spirit-led giving. As we therefore have opportunity, everybody say opportunity. Do good unto all men, and then it says especially unto the household of faith. We got a special concern for each other.
Amen.
But he says here, your predisposition, I'm getting some big words this morning.
Yes.
Must be water.
Must be water.
He said, but your predisposition is to do good unto all men. Isn't that what it says?
Yes. Right.
And then he said, but especially be mindful of the household of faith. If you see your brother and sister naked and destitute of daily food, some of them you see naked, cover them with.
Amen.
You may never recover from that side. But it said, if you see your brother or sister naked, destitute of daily food, you have it in your hand to help them, but do not. Man, you got a problem. The Word of God says then that a man who doesn't take care of his family is worse than a sinner.
Wow.
God puts some pretty high priority. Well, Pastor, I don't feel led. No, you're willfully disobedient.
Amen.
You don't wait to feel led to give. You give, you wait to feel. The Holy Spirit says, don't give there or not.
Right.
Your predisposition is to be the helper in the hands of God on this earth.
Amen.
I've heard people through the church tell me through the year, well, we're not called to have a food pantry ministry. That's for you guys. Well, read the Word of God.
That's right.
You are called, you are commanded to do so.
Amen.
And your failure to do so, you have not lived up to your obligations as a New Testament church.
That's right.
I need to go on to something else.
Good.
In some places we set it free, in others we made it mad, but this is the truth of the Word of God.
Amen.
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 See, we want to wrap our willful disobedience in a little religious cloak and dress it up. There are lots of things. Listen, there are sins of commission, things, sins of omission, things we willfully do and know is wrong, and things we ignore because we just don't feel like doing them, or they don't fit into my theology. I just don't feel like doing that today. Well, good. And they want to get up and preach about everybody else's moral failures. John 15:8. Oh, it's in Matthew 6:2, right? Let me get back there. I got hung up on wind, didn't I? I rested well last night. I ate good. You guys are in for it. Matthew 6:2, it says, therefore, when? Everybody say, when?
When,
not if. Not if you feel led. If your denomination agreed that this is what we should do in our bylaws. Therefore, when thou doest thine alms, do not sound a trumpet before thee as the hypocrites do in the synagogue and in the streets, that they may have glory of men. Verily I say unto you, they have their reward. So let me give you a little brief outline of what he's talking about. Some people in their day, the rich people, they had paid mourners in their time. That's why Jesus, when he went to raise a little girl from the dead, he said, I want all of you crybabies out of here. Why? They weren't really sad. They weren't hurt. They were paid to be mourners and to draw and attract attention to the problem. Read that story again. They were paid to attract attention to the problem, to the death that resided in the house.
Amen.
And Jesus said, I want all these people out of here, and I want Peter, James, and John. If you study their life, you want a miracle-working atmosphere, here's your little side note for some of you called to preach. He got all the mourners out of there, all the people drawing attention to the problem, and he said, Peter, James, and John, you study their lives, and you can equate that to love, faith, and fire.
Amen.
John, the book of love, right? James, the book of faith. And then Peter, he was something else, ready to go. Love, faith, and fire. There's a miracle-working atmosphere.
Yes.
But you got to get everybody out of the room to keep pointing you to the problem.
Amen.
And so these people, when they went to give, when they went to do an act, they would get people to go in front of them, and they would blow a trumpet. Look, it's 29:11, and they're coming to bring a bag of beans to this person. Look how holy and how righteous they are. And the people on the side would be, wow, they must be holy, righteous people. And Jesus said, when you go to do something for somebody, don't announce it and try to get a lot of attention for yourself, no matter what it is.
That's
right. Now, I preached at a preacher's conference once in Harrison, Arkansas. They liked it until I left and broke fellowship with me 3 days later. But on the number one reason why we don't have miracles in the church today like we used to, is because our heart motives as pastors and preachers are impure and they're ugly.
Right.
Some preachers, the only reason they want miracles is so that it can go around. Wow, Sister Suki got up out of her wheelchair and danced a jig in front of God. Why don't everybody come and see rather than giving glory to God?
Amen.
I want people healed because it's just like Jesus said in the Word of God, a lady that was bowed over, bowed down. He said, it's this daughter of Abraham who Satan has bound low these many years. It is not right for covenant people to be broke, to be sick, to be physically afflicted, and to be depressed. It's not right.
Amen.
I want to see you get free so the Word of God can come to pass on this earth.
Amen.
Oh, this room full of preachers, man, we're no different than the Pharisees, the Sadducees, and the hypocrites. We do it in Jesus' name, but come to 29:11, and David's such a great pastor. If we could just have one miracle, we could fill this church. Now in Mark chapter 2, he gives us the criteria for filling a house with hungry people. It says it was noised abroad that Jesus was in the house.
Amen.
And we need to come here and pray and invite the presence of God. And when people in the community see some of us change and see what God does in our life, then they will begin to be drawn here.
Amen.
Let me tell you this. You don't build a ministry in a church on miracles, although they're for us today.
Amen.
Huh? Because the majority of the people are like this. Well, that wasn't real. That didn't really happen. Oh, he probably wasn't hurt to begin with.
Right.
Huh? Some of the things we've seen arms and legs and heads pop and grow out. We've heard bones. We've seen things shift.
Amen.
And people sitting out there, some people, I don't know about that. So what?
Amen.
Your opinion doesn't change the fact that a valid miracle happened.
That's right. That's right.
You go away down, you can miss out, that's fine.
Amen.
One place in the Word of God said, according to your faith, be it unto you.
Amen.
Yes.
According to your faith, be it unto you. Okay? And so you don't build a ministry on miracles. You build it on the love of Jesus and the truth of the Word of God.
Amen.
People and miracles, now, and I'm not saying you or pointing anybody out, but people and miracles are like raccoons and shiny things.
Amen.
Come on.
Wow. It's interesting for that moment, and then it's over.
That's right.
Wow. I've been in places and man, to see the lady sit in a chair, her legs straight out in front of her for almost 2 hours. You can't do that.
Amen.
If anybody wants to try, I got about another hour and a half of sermon in me. Sit here. But you cannot physically do that. I've seen some things in the house of God, but generally what people do, they'll either discount it, something that just didn't really happen, I don't know about all that.
Right. How about Leah?
Or they'll see it, huh?
How about Leah?
Oh yeah, Leah, man. Her skin just sloughing off. Right? You can just wipe it off, and the doctors were freaking out. Said it'd take, what, weeks for her to heal?
Maybe months.
They said 3 to 4 weeks, maybe months. Taught you guys, you're taught here how to use the Word of God to come to pass.
Yeah.
Read in Job where it says her skin will be fresh as the day that she was born.
Amen.
Going up to Little Rock, the doctors, we don't know what we're going to do. Blah, 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 blah. Thank you for your help and your opinion, but you were wrong.
Amen.
2 days, not 2 weeks, not 2 months.
Praise God.
I mean, she looked horrible. You touch her leg and the skin would fall off, wouldn't it, Kurt?
Amen.
Horrible. Couldn't breathe. Eyes shut. Laid hands, prayed for her, spoke the truth of the Word of God, went home and went to bed. 2 days later, that baby's well. Daddy, and he said the doctor walked in the room after 2 days, didn't recognize why. He didn't expect it to happen.
Yeah.
Mama said it was more overnight. That's why the doctor came in. Who is this?
Yeah. I thought he was in the wrong room.
Yeah. Well, this is a baby whose skin was falling off. They said it'll be weeks and months. And in 2 days, learning the Word of God, appropriating the faith of God in 2 days. Well, I don't know about that. Well, we were there. I know what happened.
Amen.
Mom and Dad know what happened.
Amen.
Dan and Shirley, they were there. They know what happened.
Amen.
You understand? But you can't build a ministry on miracles because we'll lose interest in that in a given time.
That's right. Come on.
I've heard people through the years tell Kelly, now, boy, Pastor David, I'd really like to sit. If you ever had a church before we had a church, I'd like to sit and have you pastor. And I thought, no, you wouldn't. You'd be gone in a week and get mad at me talking about me.
That's right.
I've heard your pastor preach. And so when they would go give an offering, they would blow a horn and trumpet, a lot of pomp and circumstance. We all here know that's not right, right? And so the title of the sermon is Tutti Frutti, right?
Yes.
Here's what I found over 20 years of being in the church world. There are two types of people in the kingdom of God. Those who produce fruit and those who produce toots. Let me tell you then, we'll show you in the Word of God. Listen, I'll tell you this. As a pastor, it is not enjoyable for me to go preach at a church where the congregation has consistently, over years, been used to producing toots. It is not enjoyable for the Holy Spirit to enter into a congregation who for years and for years and for years have done nothing but produce toots. It's not enjoyable. Are you guys wondering where he's going with this?
Yes.
Remember, we just read to you Matthew 6:2. They went to do a righteous work, but it had to be all pomp and circumstance. In other words, I need some attention. I need some attention. Listen, I will tell you this, and this will help you. This will help me grow in the ministry. I realized long ago there are only 3 people at any given time that the attention of any service should be on. That's the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost.
Amen. Right.
I mean, we proved a week or two ago that I can leave and the ministry goes on. Obviously, this isn't the David hour.
Right.
Amen. I'm just a vessel that allows God to speak through me. And so they would go, and they would do righteous works. They knew what the Word of God said. They knew here what the Word of God said. But the heart of the author and their deeds became mechanical, and rather than capturing the praises of God, received their full reward with the praises of men. You understand, if we're not careful in the church, we can get to a place where the things we do are simply to draw attention to the pastor, to the ministry, but our goal is to draw attention to Jesus. That's it.
Amen.
That's it. Do I want people to hear about 29:11? Sure. Do I want people to like me and think I'm a good pastor? Sure. But I want their number one focus to be that of Jesus.
Amen.
See, we don't feed people and help people so that everybody can talk about how great we are. We feed and clothe people so that we can tell everybody how great God is.
Amen.
Here's a good key to a miracle-working atmosphere in your life. In Joshua, I think it's chapter 3, these are the instructions he gave him in the Old Testament. Although in the New Testament, how many of you know by the blood of Jesus we are righteous? We are holy and we are sanctified.
Amen.
But this is what he told him in Joshua. He said, sanctify yourselves. Tomorrow I will do wonders among you.
Amen.
In other words, you get obedient to the Word of God, to the will of God, to the heart of God, and you line up your inside with what you're flapping out of your mouth.
Yes.
And I will do miracles among you.
Right. Good stuff.
Why don't we see it in the New Testament church today like we used to? Impure motives.
Yeah.
Everybody's trying to get rich rather than build a relationship. The Word of God says this: as long as the Ark of the Covenant was in Obed-Edom's house, he caused him to prosper. Prosperity naturally follows the presence of God. You should write that down. That's good for you. Prosperity naturally follows the presence of God. Well, what's the problem? We're trying to get rich without the presence of God. You'll still be poor.
That's right.
Why? Because when you get it, it will destroy you like the prodigal sons. Why? Because your heart isn't lined up. You're not mature enough to handle the blessing of God in the right way. See, if you have a heart problem, giving a pack of hot dogs and macaroni to somebody who smells like Marlboro and Jack Daniel, you're not ready for the blessing of God.
Amen. Amen.
You're not ready for the blessing of God. Well, why would you say that? I told y'all before, if we're the light of the world, you turn it on in the darkness, every bug comes to the light in darkness.
Amen.
Every undesirable thing hidden in the darkness will come and flop around the light.
Amen.
One church told me that they wanted me to preach in pastors until they seen all the riffraff that dragged around with me. They couldn't understand that light attracts the undesirable things of the darkness.
That's right.
But God says that we have been given treasures in darkness.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. There are treasures in there. There are treasures down there at the Salvation Army. I'm convinced of it. There are Pastor Davids. There are leaders. There is greatness sleeping under the bridge drinking Listerine right now.
Amen.
I'm convinced of that.
That's right.
Wow. And so these people, they became mechanical. Listen, when church becomes mechanical, you need to go back. David prayed this prayer. He said, return to me the joy of your salvation.
Yes.
When church becomes mechanical, you have a problem. Listen, all the tooting and all that stuff they did, it produces a rotting smell of death called religion.
That's right.
Religion is the sister spirit to murder.
Yes.
Why? Because the seeds of it are strife and hatred.
Amen.
The Word of God says don't argue the Word of God or you'll be taken captive by Satan at his will. Amen. Religion.
Amen.
What is religion? It's man trying to please God by their works. What is relationship? Knowing that I'm pleasing to God because of His works.
That's right.
That's
right.
That's true.
Let me say that again. The difference between the rotting stink toot of religion is man trying to please God by all their righteous works.
Amen.
True righteousness is this, knowing that I'm pleasing to God because of all of His righteous works.
Amen.
And when He raised from hell, death, and the grave, He counted that righteousness and holiness to my account.
Amen.
There's nothing I can do to take away from the redemption process. There's nothing that I can do to add to the redemption process.
Amen.
It's complete. It's done. It is finished once for all. Romans 2:1 says this. Let's go there. Are you in a hurry or are you enjoying this?
Enjoying it.
All right. If not, just sneak out and go get me some chicken. Romans chapter 1. Remember, there are two types of people in the church world, in the kingdom. Those who produce toots and those who produce fruits. John 15:8, Jesus told you, the text verse we read, that His desire is that you bear much fruit. His desire. Romans chapter 2, verse 1, it says this, therefore thou art inexcusable, O man, whosoever thou art that judgest, for wherein thou judgest another, you condemn yourself. For thou that judgest doeth the same things. Where's my paper at, baby? I don't know. I lost it. Do you have your New Living? Oh, it's in here. I got it. This is my helpmate. She takes care of me.
Amen.
I told you I'm just a dummy with God's hand in my back. You didn't believe it, did you? Romans 2:1, same verse in the New Living, it says this, you may think you can condemn such people, but you are just as bad. In other words, I don't see why we're going down there to feed them. You know they got money to get drunk on. I don't see why we're going to give them a sack of groceries. They got Copenhagen and Marlboros in their pocket. Are you glad when you went to get saved?
Come on.
And God didn't say, well, you got a good job and you got money in the bank. You really don't need me.
That's right. Come on, that's good.
You're not quite as bad of a sinner as old Dave over there sucking on that pipe and shooting that needle. I'll give it all to him, but you're okay.
Right. Come on.
You got to figure this one out on your own. Amen. Degrees of love, degrees of mercy don't fit into the kingdom.
Amen.
Romans 2:1, it says this, you may think you can condemn such people, but you are just as bad. In other words, to go back to the story in Matthew, that before you start pointing things out about somebody else, you make sure your side of the street is clean.
That's right.
Now let me qualify this, and we'll set something right in the church too. It doesn't mean that your life can be lived in the church house however you want. Nobody's supposed to judge me.
Right.
That's not what God said. That's said by people who want to stay in their sin and rottenness and never be accountable to anybody. Actually, in 1 Corinthians, the Bible said that the leadership in the church body, it says if somebody calls himself a brother and they continue in such behavior, that they should be shamed and put out of the church body.
That's
right. Amen. You don't have a right to judge me. No, Paul said, I have no right to judge them that are outside of the church. But once you come in here, and especially want to be part of leadership and a functioning part of the body, your life should should begin to change.
Amen.
And Paul said there are certain people in the church who are continuing in this behavior. I won't judge the people outside of the church. Let me tell you what sinners do. Anybody got a clue yet?
Amen.
They sin. You guys got it. But Paul said, listen, here's what I've heard all through the church for long. There's a couple things. Well, y'all know there's a lot of things I'd like to hear that have crept into the church. Well, you can give other things besides money, yeah, but if you don't give money, you're still disobedient.
Yes. Right.
And the ones that say that aren't giving anything.
Right.
Well, you know, you can give time, and they sit around in this church every time, and eat popcorn and watch Jerry Springer.
Right.
And like this, in a church, you'll find this out. The people who make the most trouble do the least. They complain the most and do the least. The people that are busy, active in the church body, they're happy as can be. That's why we don't fight and complain. We don't have all that here. Why? Because we all get involved. We're doing things. We're happy. And so it says, you may think you can condemn such people, but you are just as bad and you have no excuse. See, you can't judge me. No, Paul said we are not to judge the world. But inside here, once we become members of the body of Christ, I can't condemn you to hell. But there are certain guidelines. We don't like this today in the church. There is supposed to be order in the house of God.
Amen.
There is order. There is a hierarchy. There is a government. You have responsibility and I have responsibility. And to let you, especially leaders, live your life any way you wanted, I would be doing you a disservice.
Amen.
Well, what's happened in the church today? And well, the spirit that's in the world has invaded the church.
Amen.
The spirit of rebellion has entered the church. Unaccountability has entered the church. So I'm a supervisor at my job, and here's what I found. Generally, when you tell people, hey, you need to hurry, you need to pick it up, you're not working hard enough, man, there's a wall that goes up, and pure ugly, and they're mad about it. You owe me a paycheck, I'm only working for so much an hour. Yeah, but you work for me, and you'll do what I ask you to do. Or you can have a zero on Friday, whatever you want to do. And that same thinking has entered into the church. Why? Because of where pastors and leadership of the church are concerned, there has been a mystical honor that has been removed from the pulpit. Some of it has been self-inflicted because of the way pastors have ran around and had sexual affairs. They have taken money. They have robbed, raped, and pillaged the people of God in the name of truth.
Amen.
Well, some of it's valid. And some of it is just the spirit of the world that has entered into the church. You remember me telling you that in New Testament days, when the church first started, they didn't go to court.
That's right. Yeah.
Why? They came to the pastor, and they believed that he was such a man of God, heard the word of God. Listen, if you trust me with something as precious as your children and their eternal destiny, but you can't trust me to decide the color of the light bulb or the wallpaper in the bathroom, you need to go.
That's right.
In one place, one guy said, well, I ain't giving no money. I don't like the way that he helps people and gives food. Well, don't give money. I don't care. You're not hurting anybody but you, partner. And you're going to sit here and you're going to stay ugly for the next 20 years. If you would just do what I tell you and give a box of macaroni and you would see life change as a result of it, your heart would swell and you would get hooked on it.
Amen.
Now, how do you know that in 1 Corinthians, I think it's 15:67, something like that, it talks about the household of Stephanas. It said they addicted themselves to the ministry of the saints. What does that mean? They helped God's people one time, and it felt so good, they messed around and got addicted to helping folks.
Yes.
You know, some of you have been addicts. That means they woke up in the morning. As soon as they woke up, the first thing on their mind was helping people.
Amen.
Why? They were a full-blown addict.
Amen.
I can remember being hooked on a substance, pushing a big screen TV and a shopping cart down the streets of San Diego. No shirt on, dark sunglasses, thought I looked cool. Why? Because I was addicted and I didn't care. I was going to meet that need at all costs.
Right.
And it says here, these people, they got addicted to doing good stuff for others. Yeah. Well, I ain't giving no money. He wants to give people food and stuff. I ain't about that. Well, stay in your ugly.
Amen.
But I guarantee you, the first life you see change over a pack of hot dogs that you gave will show you. You understand, when I got born again, man, I was the trash of the world. Do you understand? I am the trash of the world that everybody threw away.
Amen.
And when I got saved, the man of God, he said, bring him back here. There's something special about him. I've never been called special. I've never been called trash. He said, sit him at my table. I sat at the table. I ate a bologna sandwich, and he gave me a message Bible, and he talked to me. In fact, just years ago, he had me come. He's too old to travel now, but he had me come to Louisiana where he was ministering, and he said, I want them to meet you because you are the single most radical transformation of any life, of any person that I've ever had in 50 years of ministry. I tell you, when I came to God, I was in bad shape. Bad shape, bro. I won't wait. Well, Pastor David, where did you get that knowledge? I applied myself because I was thankful.
Amen.
I was thankful for what happened. And it was the most real thing that I've ever had in my life. And he set me at the table and he fed me and gave me the word of God. And he told my pastor, there's something special about him. You need to watch him. Be very careful. Take him under your wing and help him.
Praise God.
Praise the Lord.
Well, I'm not going to give because they're just going to feed some. Well, then don't. Do you understand? This doesn't hurt me. It doesn't hurt the church. It hurts you. Everything that we do is a reflection of our heart attitude, our inner man, and that's what God's after. But regardless of whether you give your macaroni or not, God will make sure they eat. He will make sure they're provided for. If my wife and I have to take them home and feed them, I promise you they will eat. And it will be accredited to this church through the hand of God. And so it said these people, they got addicted to the ministry of the saints. They got hooked on doing good stuff for people. Why? Because their hearts started to change a little bit. You get started doing, somebody wants to tell me, well, I don't know how to get out of all this. Well, you start doing all the good works God said to do. You don't have time to do all the bad works in the world.
That's right. Amen.
Wow. Yeah. Time to get to it. It's like this. The closer you get to the throne, the further away you get from sin and destruction.
That's right.
That's why God said, draw near to me and I'll draw near to you.
That's right.
That's actually the picture of the prodigal son. Prodigal drawing near to him and the father running out to meet him. You draw near to me, I'll draw near to you, even when you're filthy.
Yes.
Even when all hope seems lost, even when you've blown it, I will run to you.
Yes.
That's good.
That's good.
Yes. And so this one said, but you are just as bad. You have no excuse. When you say they are wicked, should be punished. You know, the preachers get up and say, you're all going to hell. Yeah.
Right.
You are condemning yourself. For you who judge others do these very same things.
That's right.
You guys know how my mind works. Like old Paul said, I may be a little crude, I may be a little rude, but not in knowledge. In other words, Brother Paul's saying the smeller's the feller. Guilty dog tends to bark first. So you make sure that you have your side of the street clean before you go pointing fingers at everybody else. That's why he says you work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. I could point out your character flaws and your moral failures till Jesus came. But guess what? If I spend time working on me and my moral failures till Jesus comes, yours are going to look a lot less.
Praise the Lord.
Here's what a lot of pastors need to understand. They are not your Holy Ghost.
Yes.
They are your guide. They are your teacher. They are your spiritual father. And whatever you do is between you and God. Work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. Why? Because I am a man covered in flesh.
Yes.
And I have to deal with the same things you deal with every day.
Amen.
Amen. One more on this, and then I'll let you go, but it's a lie. Go to Isaiah 26. But we'll hurry through the end. I don't want to lose you. Isaiah 26. Now, there are things in the Word of God. I read this verse at one church, and the guy said I offended him. I made him mad. I said, well, I didn't write it.
Amen.
He said, well, that offends me. I don't like that. I said, well, mark it out like you did the other stuff in there.
That's good.
Mark out all the stuff that offends you. Then you'll have a map and Zondervan Publishing. We'll all be happy.
Wow. That's good.
Amen. He said, well, that offended me. I don't like that. I said, well, what do you want me to do? Act like it's not in there? Isaiah 26. Told you I slept good. I ate good. I'm going to go today. Isaiah 26, starting verse 16. Remember, there are two types of people in the kingdom of God in the church world. Those who produce tubes and those who produce fruits. In other words, there are the religious and there are the righteous. Isaiah 26, 16. It said, Lord, in trouble have they visited thee. In other words, when things were falling apart, they ran to the altar and swallowed, bawled, and begged. Typical people. Mm-hmm. See, God wants us to have such a relationship in the good times, the bad times, lean times, mean times, in between times. Our relationship is the same.
Amen.
Doesn't change. Circumstance don't change my relationship with the Lord. And he said, Lord, in trouble have they visited thee. They poured out a prayer when thy chastening was upon thee. In other words, they have made their lives such a mess. Now they're at the altar squalling and bawling, God, I need help, fix this. I've been there. I've done it. And so here's what he's saying. Now listen, verse 17. Like as a woman, this guy said, this verse offended me. I don't want you to preach it like that anymore. Okay. I won't. Verse 17, listen, it said, when they were in trouble, they came running to God. When things fell apart, they ran to God. And here's what he said, like as a woman with child that draws near at the time of her delivery is in pain and cries out in her pain, in other words, oh God, help! I don't know what I'm going to do! And crieth out in her pain, so have we been in thy sight, O Lord. He said, we have been with child, we have been in pain, we have, as it were, brought forth wind. A couple of you caught that.
Yeah.
We have not wrought any deliverance in the earth, neither have the inhabitants of the world fallen. And that verse of Scripture says, you have come to the altar, you have shouted, you have hooped, you have whined, and you have begged. You have pleaded, you have moaned, you have travailed, you have pushed, and God said, it said, because all you did, you put on a big show, remember, toots and fruits.
Amen.
He said, you put on the big religious show, the tears flow, your fake eyebrows fell on the ground. Your $4,000 wig is now disheveled into the side. You've broken the bottle of miracle spring water for $19.95. Anointing oil has flies. You're screaming, you're crying, people falling all over the floor. And God said, all you managed to do was break wind. Why would he say that to them? Here's what God's saying. All the show, all the pomp and the circumstance, it doesn't impress him.
Amen.
That's right.
Because some people think they've had a great church service and really all God heard was... Why? Because if it's not motivated from our hearts to help, to love...
Right.
If it's not rooted and grounded in the Word of God and the truth of the Word of God, it is a big waste of time.
Amen.
If the pastor's motives are to be seen and to grab the accolades of men, you are bringing forth wind.
Amen.
How do you know when you haven't brought forth wind? Well, there's a couple ways, but let me give you the Bible way. He said, this is how to tell when you brought forth wind. Everybody's running around the church. Everybody's screaming. Everybody's hooping. We all feel good. We told a few jokes. But it says here, he said, you have brought forth wind when you have not wrought deliverance in the earth, neither are the inhabitants of the world following.
Wow. Wow.
We all fell on the floor. We shouted. We ran. We hollered. Why? Because nobody was set free in the church.
Amen.
No light and no truth of the Word of God came to wipe away the religious attitude and the hardness of the human heart.
Wow. Amen.
There was no compassion brought that would change your life. And God said, good show. You broke wind yet again.
Wow.
You managed to break wind yet again. And I read this years ago. I said, Lord, whatever it takes. Because see, when we do things with the right motive, we begin to break the chains and the shackles off of people's lives.
Amen.
When there's an inward change that shows itself outward,
yes.
And not just an outward modification of behavior, but an inward change inside of a man or a woman.
Amen.
And things begin to change. It is a sweet smelling savor in the nostrils of God.
That's right.
Amen. Praise the Lord.
Praise you.
All that show, all that other stuff, God says, man, that's vulgar, that's offensive, and that's rude in my sight.
That's right.
You can have religion. Listen, he told the most religious people of his day, he said, you stink like death to me.
Wow.
Amen.
Dressed just right. You went to the right schools. You even give to the poor and you give your money. But your motives are foul.
That's right.
You've taken the truth of the Word of God and you have made it a sham in order to benefit man-made doctrine. You ought to be ashamed of yourself.
That's right.
That you're the most respected people in the city. But you stink to me. There's two types, toots and fruits. Jesus said in John 15:8 that we read that his desire is that his people bear fruit. Well, what kind of fruit? Go to Galatians chapter 5 and I'll let you leave in about 5 minutes. Do you understand what I'm telling you?
Yes.
Did that offend you?
No.
I was going to say, I know where that guy goes to church. I'll let you go with him. Galatians chapter 5. One day, when true revival hits God's people again, we will understand what the anointing is.
Amen.
The anointing has been misrepresented, yes. It's been misused, and it has been prostituted in church circles.
That's right.
We think because we feel goosebumps, the anointing's there, not necessarily.
Right.
You'll know just like this when God said you travailed, you whined, you screamed, and you brought forth wind. The same thing, the mark of the anointing when it's truly there is that yokes will be destroyed and burdens will be removed.
Yeah.
When the truth of the Word of God is preached in a pure motive with the right heart and it's received, your yokes will be eternally destroyed. The burdens that have weighed you down will be lifted and removed.
That's
right.
Not we run around and dance and do the stanky leg. And then we go out of church and everything's just a big mess as it was. My mind's still racked with confusion. Depression still leads me around.
Yeah.
Anger is still what I motivate my life. Selfishness and greed consume me. I can't walk by the opposite sex without lusting. But boy, that was anointed because we all danced and shouted and I got a doodad on my ear though. No, the mark of the true anointing is when yokes are destroyed and the burdens are removed from your life and freedom comes to you.
Amen.
The rest of it is just...
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Jesus said, my desire is that you bear fruit. Well, what fruit? Go to Galatians chapter 5. Galatians chapter 5, verse 22. It said, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such there is no law. And they that are Christ have crucified the flesh with the afflictions and the love. If we live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit. What does that mean? He's saying, look, here's the difference. The people in the kingdom that produce toots and the ones that produce fruits, there is a visual difference in their lives.
Amen.
God created you to be a fruit producer.
Amen.
I will tell you this, and then I will go away. You can tell when you move from religion to righteousness when your character is transformed to that of our Messiah.
Amen. Thank you, Lord.
When you look like Jesus.
That's right.
I'm talking about a beard and sandals and long hair.
Right on.
That's what you want to do, have at it. But listen, the mark of maturity in the kingdom of God is not keeping a bunch of rules and regulations and dress codes. The mark of maturity in the kingdom of God is Galatians 5:22. When we walk in here and we become fruit producers rather than tube producers. You understand, we're no longer coming in the presence of the King and offering things that are offensive to Him.
Amen.
The body says, the Bible says in Romans chapter 12, to offer your bodies a living sacrifice. It goes on to say, this is your reasonable service. That phrase, reasonable service, is from the Greek logikos. And here is what He's saying to you. After you get born again and you hear the truth of the Word of God, the only logical thing that should happen is your body should start to conform to that of the Word of God.
Right.
What does that mean? That I no longer yield my body as an instrument of sin. And now the purity that's in my spirit conforms my body to that of the Master Jesus. Hallelujah.
Amen.
And He said, I want you to bear much fruit. Let me tell you this, how you tell if you're maturing in the Lord, and I'll leave you alone. Maturity doesn't come with years in the body. If you're sitting with a person who doesn't teach you the Word of God, you'll be a baby 20 years from now.
That's right.
Maturity, I bet people have been in the church world 25 years, they're still troublemakers, and they're still ugly.
That's right.
But neither mature. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God.
Amen.
This is when you know that you're mature in the kingdom of God, when fruit begins to pop out all over you.
Amen.
When Galatians 5:22 is a reality in your life, you have become mature in the kingdom of God. Not because you know theology, not because you know codes and creeds, but because your character has conformed to the greater one who lives on the inside of you. Somebody here have a word? Something stirring in them right now?
I heard the Lord say that we scatter to and fro. We scatter like hens and we go to and fro. We need to be quiet and listen. Quiet and listen, and He will show us the way. He has given us the word. He's given us the instructions. There's no longer any excuses. Quiet yourself and follow the Lord and He will lead the way.
So Father, today we thank You.